this very kind and pleasant words. As you heard, I spent some time in the Philippines. I was working in Fugao province in 85-88. I was there repeatedly ever since. So I have close links to the Philippines. And also, but the reason why I'm here is in the context of a research conference we have in Manao in the next 3 or 4 days, which is finalizing a research project on sustainable land use in the European Crisis. So for today, the topic is this IPBES pollination assessment. And as I said before, I was involved there in this assessment as a so-called CLA, according to the lead author of one of the chapters, which is show the structure in a moment, which means we're in charge of private chapters, so we try to integrate all the knowledge we have about drivers and how they impact pollination, pollinators, pollination services, etc. I was heavily involved in several assessments before, and just to give you a short overview, let's see what it works now. Okay. Some delay. I was working for the IPCC before, actually, as a CLA in the last report, assessment report 5. I was working there also with some policymakers relating mainly issues of climate change and ecosystems on a global scale. And as mentioned, now the pollination part I present today was CLA of drivers and pollination and pollinators, was the title of the chapter. And as also mentioned here, I was co-editor of the pollination report. And on the next period of IPBES of the global assessment, it will be officially announced on Monday. I will be one of the 3 co-chairs of the global assessment. That's a very new step on the global scale, but that's something I don't talk about today because it's still work in progress. It's just starting. We have the first meeting in 2 weeks from now in Bonn with 120 select authors all across the globe. So coming back to IPBES, intergovernmental platform, or sometimes it's a science policy platform on biodiversity services, that's the title of it. And IPBES has a kind of work program with the following structure. They have 4 main objectives. The first one is strengthen the capacity and knowledge foundations of the science policy interface to implement key IPBES functions. Number 2 is strengthen the science policy interface of biodiversity and ecosystem services at and across the sub-regional, regional and global levels, a kind of hierarchical structure there. Number 3, strengthen the knowledge policy interface with regard to thematic methodological issues. In this field is also the place where some of the assessments have their home, let's say. Objective 4 is communicate and evaluate IPBES activities, deliverables, and findings. So contrary or let's say different from IPCC, IPBES goes far beyond doing assessments, but still assessments are a core part of the IPBES activities. Now this can be broken down in objectives and deliverables. I don't want to read you to read all this, but these are the subsets we work on. And what I talk about today, that's the one on the pollination. So objective 3, number 8, was a thematic assessment on pollination and food production. So the link between food production and pollination was a kind of focal topic there. So that's the title once again, deliverable 3A of the IPBES process. First, a combination of people. So we had an expert team of around 90 experts from all regions globally. We had 2 co-chairs, one from the UK and one from Brazil. We had 17 coordinated lead authors, 44 lead authors, 13 refugee editors, and 1 technical support staff from the United Nations placed in Bonn in Germany. So this was a team working on this issue. It was a long process for the selection. It's always very hard to select the right balance geographically, scientific background, gender balance, many things we had taken into consideration. And only people can be authors who are nominated by the governments or by other governments or by some organizations, for example NGOs as well. That was a rich representation of the authorship, just on the map. You see Philippines is not in green, so there was no Philippine partner as author in this team, but it's quite nice spread across the globe, I would say. Of course, US is a large country and Canada as well, that's why it's a green spot, but China is quite important. But it was a nice balance globally, trying to have all the regions included in this effort. The framework for the whole thing goes along the framework, which is the IPBES one. So this is the IPBES idea. We found details about good quality of life. It's about direct drivers, about nature and nature benefits to people. And we tried to arrange our activities in the pollination assessment precious chapter 2, the one I was in charge of, status and trends, to look at the status and the trends, in this case of pollinators and pollination services across time and space. Looking at impacts and values, a lot has to do with valuation, monetary and non-monetary valuation in this context, and responses, how you can react to, let's say, threats, which are, let's say, threatening pollination services. The report has 6 baseline chapters, each of them executive summaries, and the main texts will have around 350 pages in the printed version. It's not yet finished in terms of printing, but should be finished any day now, something like this. But that's what we are told already for 2 months, so it might still take some time, I don't know. We have a summary of policymakers, which is summarizing the main findings, and 23 key messages, 10 pages supporting text, and that's translated into 6 UN languages. So English, French, Arabic, Russian, Chinese, and well, at least Spanish. It's 6 languages. And this is how the thing looks like. You have the background, the pollination. These are the draft text pages on the non-printed version. We have the drivers, we have 200 pages of text in the final version. Status and trends, 100 pages. Economic valuation and biocultural diversity, pollinators, and then social cultural values. Quite a tricky topic, but it was quite interesting because it was the first time that in such an assessment tried to incorporate indigenous and local knowledge combined with, let's say, the typical scientific type of knowledge into one documentation. It was a really hard effort. It's still a long way to go, but it made a first quite important step. And I think this is an important part of the entire exercise. And then last one was the responses, the risks and opportunities associated with pollinators and pollination. Around 100 pages again and a glossary. That's how the whole thing looks like. So, first something on the process. All these assessments, IPCC as well as IPBES, have certain, let's say, autographs. So, 0 autograph, first, second, sometimes third one, and the final output. So, you start drafting something. First text, if someone gets some kind of bullet points, this is going out for internal review, and it's just a report. So, a very drafty thing where your, let's say, colleagues and friends make some first comments where you got all the important points. So this is still kind of a bit informal internal. Based on these comments, you make the first autograph. This is finished. It goes out for review by experts. So everybody can, let's say, register globally and say, I'm an expert on the behavior, I don't know, of Asian honeybees, or something like this. And you'll be accepted as an expert, you can comment on the text we have. So we write all the comments there, and we have to, let's say, deal with all the comments we receive from everybody on a global scale. Come back to the numbers of comments later because it's a really huge number you have to work with. So make a second autograph. Out of this you make kind of a second review, make a report, summary, and it's again reviewed by experts and by governments. So in this case all the governments make comments on the last or the second draft of your whole assessment. And this leads into the final report that should be agreed upon, hopefully, by the plenary United Nations level. So IPBES has meetings, the last one was Kuala Lumpur, last February, but then this report, for example, was accepted by the plenary, by all governments present, as a kind of anonymous vote. So everybody has to agree with the final version of the summary of policymakers, and everybody has to agree with the overall document without detailed discussions. So finally, for by governments, this is especially for summary of policymakers. So we got 10,300 comments in this process. From 280 governments or expert reviewers, 280 different units supplied some comment. So this combined first autograph, second autograph, and over 50 countries were reviewed, received during the review process. So 50 countries made comments. IPBES has 125 member countries at the moment. So let's say a bit more than 40% made the comments. 10,300 comments means you have to go to each single comment and reply to the comments, each single one. And to say what you did with this comment. So if you say, I agree with your comment, you put it in the text, that's very easy. But many comments are not the case, so you have to argue why you did what you did. And imagine an Excel spreadsheet with 10,300 lines, that's what's in front of you. Then you go through it one by one with a team of other people, of course, but still, that leaves something like, I don't know, 100 comments, 1,000 comments, that's to single small groups. So it's a long work, lots of patience, where you try to, let's say, do justice to all those comments which came in from the outside. Oftentimes people just want to have their own paper cited. Okay, well, that's sometimes it's justified, sometimes they say, okay, this topic was already covered, we don't need additional. this, but you also have to write a reply to each of these comments. So there's a really process where you need a lot of patience. You know, also try to be fair. That means don't do more than 200 comments a day, because otherwise after some time your patience might not be sufficient anymore to make a polite and nice answer. But it's good to know for everybody all the comments which are placed there and all the answers you give will get public after the process is over. So all the things you write can be read by everybody. This helps to keep a kind of, let's say, nice, moderate, polite style in the way you do things. Otherwise, you might just write some kind of not so nice words about the things you do. That's all the report looks like. It's just a report from the government platform, blah, 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 validation, connected to production. That's the team editing the whole thing. These are the two co-chairs, plus one person from the technical support unit. These are the drafting team, or one of the drafting team members for the summary policy makers. These are all the others, who had the central roles in the process. So we, as a team, edited the entire report. Publishing company to be inserted. It will be published by IPBS as a kind of, let's say, book on demand type of thing. So it's not a publisher like an IPC, that was Cambridge University Press. So it's just a kind of IPBS activity. But it will be put as PDF online anyhow, so everybody can download the whole document. It's not yet finalized because we still have some issues with copyrights of figures, for example. It's not trivial. They all write copyrights of all the pictures you use in this document. Then of Kuala Lumpur, there's just a picture of sitting here somewhere, this is our friend from Brazil, the Simon Potts, the other co-chair, that's Bob Watson, who is now the chairman, the overall boss of IPBES from the UK. He was IPCC boss before, some years back, and this was kind of atmosphere there. So in these meetings, summary for policymakers, you go through the whole document line by line, sentence by sentence, and you have to agree with all the governments in the room on the exact wording of the text. That's the most painful step, let's say, because you have to really negotiate back and forth and find a common solution, which is acceptable by the policymaker, but which is still kind of scientifically okay. So this kind of balance is not always easy to achieve. It took us, I don't know exactly, something like 12, 14 hours for negotiating these 10 pages. That was quite okay. That's twice the speed of IPCC. That was the comparison we had. IPCC was much slower, but also IPCC was much higher on the agenda so far. So the awareness is higher, that's why we have more discussions on it. Also, delegations have been more in IPCC, 150 countries, but here only around 90 to 100 have been in the place in Kuala Lumpur. So it also makes things easier if there are less countries involved, of course. Coming to the results, I'll try to summarize the major findings we had. Mainly from the summary of policymakers. That's partly in our documents, which you will find printed very soon. But some are not printed because some of them have copyright issues. That's why I can't give you the PDF right now. You have to modify some of them and you get another version to put it online. Okay, first point is diverse, as you might imagine. Lots of species around the globe. So these are, for example, all wild pollinators, some examples, flies and colibri birds, for example. Bees, of course, bumblebees. But also some mammals are pollinating, for example, in Australia. Just showing the diversity of different species groups which are in charge of, let's say, animal pollination on a global scale for crops as well as for non-crop plants. So these are the white ones. We also have the managed ones, or the honeybee type of thing, the Western honeybee, the Asian honeybee, but also many other bumblebees, for example, are managed. So these are the ones which are, let's say, kept by man to some extent and nurtured and used for active pollination, mainly of crops, either out in the field or in glasshouses. Just to show some diversity, that's a combination of both. It's just this kind of reflection of what is there, which place of the globe, which continent. So very roughly, just showing diversity of pollinators. Wireless benefits, more than 75% of the leading food crops are depending on pollination. Almost 90% of the world's flowering plants rely at least in part on animal pollination. There's really a large number of plant species which rely to quite some extent, or lesser extent, depends very much on the plants, on pollination. Economic value, you can do some kind of calculations. Animal market value linked to pollinators, US dollars, that's $235 to $570 billion per year, depending on how you calculate these things. It's mainly based on the dependence of a certain crop on pollination. And it's a world market price in a certain year, very simplified now. This gives this value of 250, 300, 400 billion US dollars globally per year. The value produced by pollinators in terms of crop production, so the crops we use, which depend on pollination. depending on this one. So MA bonding crops are a key source of vitamins and minerals. These are some examples here of vitamin A. The darker it is, the more it's kind of pollination dependency on vitamin A supply, for example, India here, or iron pollination dependency, or some others. Many factors you can look at. In many contexts, pollination plays a quite important role also for healthy human diets. As I said, we have many aspects of additional local knowledge in the report, and some of beekeeping and honey hunting is quite an important aspect. Of course, everybody thinks of honeybees first to talk about pollination, but it's just one species out of many, many thousands of species. And this is the anchor of many rural livelihoods. We put some pictures there in Cameroon, for example, hunting up trees here, or in Ethiopia, some of Mexico, or here in India. It's very specialized type of beekeeping and honey hunting in many places across the globe. Many others beyond food, so we have medicines, biofuels, fibers, structural materials, for example. There's just some pictures here, cotton, for example, here are eucalypts or canola. And it's important to say the source of inspiration for art, music, literature, religion, and technology are also quite relevant. So we try also to cover those fields in the assessment which are not so often really in the focus of discussions. So people tend to focus on crop production, value of the crops, these kind of things, but much less on, let's say, cultural aspects, spiritual values, etc., which are also quite important, which can be nicely shown in the context of pollination. Significance for niches and local knowledge systems, just some examples. I mean, traditional clothing, some traditional costumes, which contain pollination. These are here, the butterfly, there's a bee on one of these things from South America. There was one report also done especially on ILK in the context of pollination. So a team of ILK people met together to write a report on what they have so far obtained of ILK related information on pollination as a baseline for us, who are natural scientists, and to some extent natural scientists, to work on the assessment. So this was done some 3 years ago as a baseline report for us. Looking at the status of wild insects, so there's a decline in diversity and occurrence of some bees, hoverflies, and butterflies in Europe and North America. That's mainly a matter of databases, so we have good databases in this part of the world, but much worse than others. Some 30% of bee species are threatened in some national lists. There are only a few countries that have national lists, but there bees always have a high percentage of endangered species. 99% of European bee and butterfly species are threatened according to IUCN criteria. We only have the IUCN red list for Europe, that's why we only have data for European. And of course, lack of data for many other regions includes assessments of status, but some reports of declines are existing on a global scale. So you have scattered information all across the globe, and only a few systematic observations, mainly in North America and some Europe. That's about it. Also, the Philippines, it's not so easy to really obtain the data on long-term trends. There's still a long way to go to establish good monitoring schemes, not only for pollinators, but for any kind of wildlife, maybe except birds, this might be a bit better, but for any species, it's tricky. The cost of decline, of course, among the threats, these are just the headings we dealt with in this chapter 2, the land use change in general, then the intensive agricultural management. Pesticide application is heavily discussed in the context of bees and pollination. GMO crops is one issue we discussed there. Pathogens and pests, especially in beekeeping, pathogens are quite important. Climate change is one issue which plays a role in combination with the others. Invasive alien species, and of course, the interactions of these factors, which are very hard to detect because there's hardly any reasonable good, nice design study. We can really, let's say, find out which is the major factor, which is maybe less important, how they interact. So it's often difficult to link specific drivers to observe declines. So what we have is many correlations of something A with something B, but you never know if it's a causality or if it's just a correlation, nothing else. That's very hard to find out. That's why you need experimental approaches to come closer to, let's say, explaining trends rather than just observing and correlating them. Just going through some of these things and the results here in the report. So land use change is first a risk, so it reduces food nesting and other resources, lots of habitat fragmentation, degradation aspects. It applies to agricultural, natural, urban, and biocultural areas. Bioculture refers to indigenous local people mainly, which was a big discussion. The term bioculture in the meeting in Kuala Lumpur took us 2 hours of discussion whether it can be kept or not. It was the United States of America blocking the entire process. They had to phone back to Washington and to make an agreement that they can accept the term in the whole document. This alone took 2 hours of discussion and one night waiting until the phone call was done. Came back in the morning, they agreed with a footnote, we can keep it. Otherwise, it might have just stopped the entire process. So if one country does not agree with something, that's a problem of consensus documents, it might block the entire process. This was luckily, it was at 10 or 11 in the evening, so quite late already. I said, I have to phone Capitol delegate from the USA, which means Washington. So okay, let's go to sleep. Washington is still awake, so we can phone there and come back to the results tomorrow morning. We had some discussions overnight on how to solve it. There was a phone call with Washington. In the end, they accepted bioculture as a term, with a footnote that it refers especially in this report to diversity of local people and local knowledge in relation to pollination. So this context was acceptable. There are many political issues in the background, especially in the US in this case, which made him nervous about the term. The only point is, if you come up with this in the very final meeting, that's been unfair. You have two years of time to comment on this. There was no comment from the US on this term in the first 2 years, but in the very last meeting, they brought this up. This always happens if some country discovers something which they really don't like. Okay, just a short kind of excursion on this topic. Then we have lots of practices based on ILK. That's because loss of practice of ILK knowledge channels can be eroding and also context of pollination, this is the case. Responses to land use change provide food and necessary resources. If you really want to focus on pollination, you can manage to restore native habitat patches, you can establish protected areas or increase habitat heterogeneity. What we do, for example, in the research in nature, in this rice context, oftentimes this ecological engineering activities where you try to insert more flower strips, flower resources, which are good for pollinators on the one hand, which are also good sources for some of the parasitoids, which again attack insect pests of rice. So you have kind of double win situation if you use this flower strips as a food resource for parasitoids and for pollinators, pollinating crops. This applies again to agriculture, to natural and urban areas. Other responses, we have some practice based on ILK again, in co-productive science, via source of solutions. This just shows places where we had information about ILK activities in the context of pollination. So favoring heterogeneity landscape, for example, and also the kinship relationships, the taboos and totems that protect pollinators in the habitat. So that pollinators are the reason to protect certain patches of forest, for example. So a quite interesting role there also to support biodiversity in general. Intensive agriculture is another risk. Put it here, for example, last year one year this is a wheat production. You can also sometimes think about rice, but it depends very much on this intensive, but it's very diverse, but quite diverse compared to many other cropping systems. So there we have the loss of non-cultivated habitat patches. There are only a few, maybe there's no other patch inside here. There might be a few here. Large field size monocultures are always a problem. That's a long time, that's known for a long time already. Also, high use of fertilizers and herbicides creates difficulties. In many cases, intensive grazing, where you have grazing schemes, grazing systems, which is more the case in many temperate countries rather than in tropics. But it depends where you are. Philippines does not really huge areas of grazing. They don't produce much milk, for example, maybe some beef. A dairy farm here, it will be a bee maybe. Responses. Flower and habitat, I mentioned already before, support organic farming as far as possible, feasible, strengthening existing diversified farming system and reward farmers for good practices as well as things you can do as a political intervention as well. Pesticides was a big topic, so actually the process of the entire assessment is as follows. You receive a scoping document where these governments in the IPBES process put down all the points which they think you should deal with while writing your assessment. And there was one element on pesticides, and because there was a big discussion 2 years ago up to now about this neonicotinoid pesticides, this was especially mentioned as one group of pesticides you have to deal with. So pesticides, especially neonics, was mentioned there. So it also reflects kind of political discussion agenda, where they did the scoping documents, and then they went to the scientists and say, okay, that's something you want to know more about, please summarize and assess the state of knowledge. So pesticides, of course, have a broad range of lethal and some lethal effects. The index for variety compound, toxicity, exposure level, location, pollinator species, some are more susceptible wages can be increased by, for example, labeling is insufficient or not respected. That's often the case in many agricultural systems. The application equipment is faulty or not fit for purpose. You have kind of, let's say, low level standards in your system, in your techniques. The risk assessment or regulations are insufficient. Some examples here. Responses: raise standards, risk assessment, of course, regulation pesticide use. Reduce the usage as far as possible. In many cases, pesticides are also used, which is not nearly necessary, but it's also a matter of psychology. We might follow this, maybe a discussion if you like later, if you have some questions on this. Or you can seek alternative forms of pest control. IPM is long known, and it depends very much on how you define IPM. There are very different definitions from different viewpoints. Sometimes pesticides are an integral part, or let's say an early part of the process, and oftentimes it's a kind of last resort. You also use pesticides as well, in other cases, so it depends very much how you put this. Great farmers extension is the land management best practices. You also have to be aware of these statements on a global level. So at the end of such a long process, you might just end up with something that starts with trivial sometimes, because all that stuff we know. The important thing is, this is backed up by many detailed references, which refer to the statements, making to really follow up the state of the art in this context. Additive technologies to reduce spray drifts, for example, with dust emissions, so kind of high-tech spraying here, let's say, bringing out pesticides in the field, which doesn't cause much contamination of your environment. GMO crops was also discussed to some extent. It's actually dealing with two components: your herbicide tolerant crops, and of course, high herbicide use may reduce the pollinator and forage, but it's always the case whether it's GMO one or others. As soon as you have, let's say, high herbicides, it's always a problem for food resources, for pollinators. And look at insect-resistant crops. You have some little effects which are largely unknown. There are quite some effects known, of course, on organisms which are closely related to your target organism. So if you take, for example, GM corn, which is against Lepidoptera pests, of course, other Lepidoptera might be affected by this BT corn because it's the same mechanism which works. So if these are non-target groups, are closely related to your target groups, of course you have some problems there. So that's something you have to find solutions, whether you want to accept this damage or you don't want. It's a political thing in the end, how you decide. So we just put together here the information we had. So there's some information about some of the effects, but many things are unknown still in the context of GMO IR-resistant crops. Responses, again, risk assessment standards quite important. And quantify indirect and some of the effects of GM crops on pollinators. And logic consequence, what I just said before. Climate change is used for some pollinators, for example, bumblebees and butterflies. You want to call butterflies pollinators, some do pollinate bees, some others don't. You have changes in the ranges, you have other abundance and shifts in seasonal activities, and risk of disruption of future crop pollination. So systems might simply change because of different climatic conditions, which affect different components of the system in different ways. For many bee species, especially honeybees, climate change is not a big issue because they are, as you might know, able to regulate the temperature in the hive, for example, so they are more, let's say, macroclimatically independent from their environment because they regulate their own climate. And of course, the climate shifts across landscapes may exceed species of burst ability, as is often the case. If the climate is shifting to certain regions, it might be faster than the movement abilities, so to say, of species to follow the climate shifts, which relates also to the availability of certain habitats in this, let's say, new climatic settings. The response is largely untested, but could potentially include target habitat creation or restoration. That's a thing we try, for example, in temperate Europe to some extent, or increase crop diversity to, let's say, buffer a bit against this kind of potential effects on networks or on ecosystems. So the summary, put it in very few words. The main thing is, we have a lot of information, and it shows now. We have 250,000 publications in the last 10 years on pollination. 250,000. Nobody can read it. We have analyzed in our process around 2,500, which we have really cited in the report. We might have read something like 4,000 in more detail, and we just decided for 2,500 to cite them. And in this ones are the baseline for the things we do here. Then you, let's say, put the things together in a more, let's say, concise way in the chapters. Then out of this, you make the summaries. So first thing, as I gave before, then the summary of summaries, these are the four bullet points. But in the end, it has to be a very clear, simple message as it's supposed to be used in policy making, but you always have to be able to trace back all the information to the very scientific detail. So from this we can say there's well-documented declines in some wild and managed pollinators. They both, the wild one and the managed ones, provide us with a broad range of benefits. I mentioned some figures before, this monetary values, but also others. They face multiple threats, just as some of them before, or maybe all of them, climate change, pesticides, data change, of course. And there are a wide range of response options to protect pollinators, drawing on both scientific and local knowledge. So these are the four statements he gave at the very end of this assessment. So this will be, let's say, the main part of my talk. And I always have to check off how much time I still have. How much time I have left? So maybe I should stop here. So this will be the whole thing. That's the team, by the way, the last meeting we had in the Rome in FAO, the whole pollination team. And I could now present something about assessments contrary to refuse. So what's different? Because many people don't really know what's an assessment compared to refuse. So as scientists, you tend to make refuse on certain topics, try to cover all the literature in there. The assessments to try to get the essence. So I guess we'll still follow this a little bit. But also give you some impressions of how these processes work, which I could use for some IPCC pictures. I gave a talk here 1 year ago, somewhere the other place over there, with IPCC.
CESA,
okay. That's something I... Who has been in this talk 1 year ago, which I gave here? Okay, there's no overlap, so I could just repeat this. So what I would propose, mention some brief more things about the process. I use the example of IPCC. For this, I just have to skip some of the slides. Sorry. That was me in 1985 in the Philippines, by the way. This was my fieldwork in Captain Fugao, so that's me. Just to see, individual succession often takes place. Things are changing, you often change, of course, in your outfit. You lose some hair, you gain something else. And as an entomologist, as you could imagine, so I was in the field with insects ever since. Okay, but that was the main point. So I want just to skip this one. It's about the assessments. Maybe I just managed to bring in one point maybe here for the assessment. Assessment is a critical evaluation of knowledge for a specific theme or region. Here in literature or grain literature, it involves analyzing, synthesizing, and critically judging available information, and confidence terms are assigned to key messages. So what we actually did was in the process of this IPBEST pollination assessment. Those papers which were quite controversial, those publications, we went back to the original publication, read in very detail, and really checked it once again that all the statements made there are really backed up by good information. And if you go into detail, you discover quite a large number of high-ranking journal publications where you always say, how could they make it into realm of science or nature or something? Because there's some kind of basic mistakes which have been done there. Especially if you get comments on your report from certain interest groups. So everybody can comment, as I said before, in the review process. So if you get a comment from the chemical industry or from an NGO, so it doesn't matter, they're very similar in the end, because they want to emphasize certain paper. So if some information like this comes from the industry, NGO, or some groups which have certain interests, we always tended to really check in detail why do they really recommend this paper. So one example of a science paper where it was said there was no effect of neonics observed on pollination. The statement wasn't wrong, but there was no research done on neonics in this paper. So that's something which we can really use. That was used by the industry in this case to say, okay, there's another paper which proves this, it's no problem. But a paper didn't really prove this. There also have been papers from the other side saying this study proved that neonics are very important, they affect bees quite heavily. Looking at detail, the setup of the experiments was really very, very, let's say, very weak. So statements could not be made from this setup of the experiment which they published there. So all these things means you go critically back to the original source and try to see what's really there. You can only lose a few papers, but mainly those which are highly disputed or highly discussed. So very important papers oftentimes are important because they make some kind of, let's say, very maybe simple statements which might not always be totally correct. That's a tough thing to do because you can't go back to all this original paper. So just select those which are high on the agenda politically to really see what's really written there. So that's one of the aspects in the context of this assessments. Here we make confidence strokes, which means you never know if something for sure. You just can say it's highly, less likely that this is the case, or it's low confidence. Depends on how much information you have. So you rate your information according to the available knowledge and to the degree of agreement among the different sources of something. So if you have, let's say, 10 papers on the effect, let's take this neonics again, and they all agree in a certain direction, that's very easy, you have high confidence in statements. But if you have, let's say, 3 papers only, one in this direction, 2 in the other, and only 3 papers, you can't really tell that much. Because your statement is still very weak because the backup scientifically is not very strong. So that's also one of the elements in this assessment. You try to make some confidence terms on the knowledge you have. So when you make a statement, then you say, okay, that's highly likely, or we're very confident, or we all have limited confidence that this will need further exploration, further research. So you can also look in such a way here, comparing assessments and scientific review on the middle here, and on the right, the assessment, audience, scientists versus decision makers, and the authors are one group of you self-organized, just meet some friends and write a review. In this case, like these assessments and the IPPS and IPCC, we have NASH transdisciplinary chosen from a nomination by governments and stakeholders. That's a very different combination of people. Or in the high diversity of, let's say, different perspectives, that's a big difference. That means you have a much more balanced, I would say, view on all the topics, which are especially here relevant for decision making. And you identify gaps for knowledge, that's for the research needs, sorry about that, but an assessment and knowledge for implementation, so the focus, the different directions different. For example, uncertainty statements are not required in reviews, but essential in assessments. Judgment on relevance for policy is optional in one case, but it's required and clearly flagged. It has to be non-prescriptive. And that's another point of all these assessments, they all have to be policy relevant and not policy prescriptive. Yeah. It means you have to be very clear in the language you choose. So you never can say, this is something you have to do as a government. You just can say, you have the options A, B, C, D, with this consequence A, B, C, D. That's your choice. So you also have to be careful not to, let's say, prescribe policies. You just can show options. So it's relevant for policy making, but you're not a policy maker. You're the scientist trying to summarize the knowledge in a kind of digestible way for policy making. Okay, this is some experts elements here. The summary of the broad audience. That's something I presented today, was a kind of summary for the broad audience of the main findings. The document, as I said, has 350 pages. The manuscript has 800 pages of text and 2,500 references, so you can always go into detail. The slides today are just the bullet point summaries of the things we did here. Okay, these are some of the most important, let's say, aspects between assessments and reviews. Finding the balance, credibility, relevance, legitimacy. These are the three very important points here which you need in an assessment. So credible is important, it's to be perceived as quality and trustfulness of the results. It's a very much linked process, transparency process, and also of the willingness of people to really deal with all the issues you have in a fair way. I mentioned before, the comments you make from all the review comments we receive have to be very fair, very open, very transparent. So all these kind of things are very important. Okay, what is relevant is very clear. And the involvement of experts from all regions and backgrounds is another aspect here. So the relationship makes it result. That's why this is so complicated, to find the right combination of people on a global scale to work on such an issue. Okay, and this is, let's skip all these ones. And just some last slides. All this work goes. This is, I can see it's much harder than IPPS so far. It was the meeting in Yokohama 2014. He was the co-chair in Chris Field. Yes, there was working group 2 that was impacts of climate change. And this, we had late night negotiations. So at a certain stage of time, you are coming at the physical border of your possibility, to put it like this, physical limits. This is still before midnight because after midnight translation is finished, no more earmarks. So we work, for example, on the IPCC, one session Saturday morning at 10 o'clock until Sunday afternoon 4 without any break. So there was 1.5, we did 2 days, the night through, to finish a document. So the thing people have in mind, all of us there, they don't want to be the reason for such a document to fail. So the example I mentioned, the US with the biocultural diversity was such a thing also. They didn't want to be the reason to fail to try to find solutions. And also, the other side takes so long. At the very end, everybody wants to achieve the consensus documents, and you have to fight really hard. So after midnight, it gets faster because there is no translation. Everything is only in English. It's a bit unfair for some colleagues from China, maybe from Russia. But of course, for others like us in Germany, our language isn't there anyhow, so it's a topic for foreign language. So nighttime is in English, and in the morning, translation comes back with the six languages there again. So everything is done in six languages all the time, normally, with negotiations. Later at night, there are empty seats, many of them. This was 600 delegates have space here, and four in the morning, only one of them have been left. But still, all the decisions made are binding for all the ones who have the chance to be there. Very late looks like this, and if you work there all night through, that's how you feel. It's kind of, it's really kind of difficult at the early morning. I had to defend one of our parts. I had to defend the figure here, so I'm sitting somewhere here. That was 5:30 in the morning, Sunday morning, 5:30, all night through. So I was lucky that nobody really objected to our figure. But maybe it was just because of physical conditions, you never know. But a colleague of mine, this one here, a friend in the same chapter, had one figure a bit later, it was this one here. This one was killed. So this figure just shows, very different example, a drought and heat induced tree mortality around the globe. It just shows places where there have been studies showing that there's tree mortality due to drought and heat. There was one delegate from Africa, he came back from the hotel, 6 in the morning, it's still sleeping. He read drought and saw no dog in the Sahara. And it was impossible to convince him that it's about trees. And you know, trees in the Sahara are not very abundant. So you can have really no tree studies in the Sahara, that's why there are no dogs. So he made one mistake. We as authors should have written tree mortality induced by drought and heat. I'm sure it would have gone through. So this is the kind of limitation, if you're physically too exhausted, these things might go wrong. So this figure was killed because there was one delegate did not agree. We could not convince him in this early morning setting of the Sunday morning. So that's some more impressions. There was my friend from Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia was very interested in the climate change context, carbon budgets. They had 8 lawyers as delegation. There was always somebody totally fresh sitting there, a lawyer that had their own views on carbon balance, UK. And the press, of course, there as well. Okay, so this was some impressions. The last moment shows on IPCC, but the process are like this. You might have to spend quite some time, you need a lot of patience, to convince all the people in the room to agree on a certain text. It might happen in some cases also, like the best was here case, that you need a kind of, let's say, break. So you have, let's say, 1 hour break. Most delegates have to break. And the most controversial discussing countries meet together, maybe 10 countries, and draft a solution for the plenary later again. Then you go back into plenary and hopefully accept this kind of things. So it's quite an interesting diplomatic process. The baseline is natural science, like in coordination, but there's so many policies involved there as well, that's why it's not so easy to really find an agreement between science and policy making. So that's enough for the moment. Thank you very much for your patience.